The USDA NRCS offers in most states a high tunnel system practice that provides technical and financial assistance. The financial assistance varies from state to state. It covers a portion of the producer's cost in installing a high tunnel system. It needs to be sited on existing cropland that needs to solve a resource concern. A resource concern is plant productivity, health, and vigor, which also can be associated with improved nutrient management, pest management, and irrigation water management because you're controlling all of those factors. High tunnel system differs from a greenhouse in that a high tunnel system, you're growing crops in the natural ground or on raised beds, but in the natural soil profile.
For this first season, as we kind of get acclimated and learn really how to grow effectively in a high tunnel system, we're gonna trial some crops, cucumbers, peppers, and growing ginger undercover, just to see how all of those crops kind of do in this condition. We have been growing on the east side for 20 years, scaling up our urban farming practices for many years, so it's super exciting to be able to really take it to the next level and create more of an urban farm and be able to extend the season for when we can grow food and offer food through our programming and through our farm.
Depending on the size of the structure, you're gonna have to haul it on a trailer, a flatbed, or a semi might have to deliver it, anywhere from 1 to 3 or 4 pallets. You need to be prepared with a forklift. Otherwise, you can break the crates down at the truck and haul them down individually. You want to try to site that structure where it's already fairly level. Depending on the county or the township permitting requirements, there could be a building permit needed, setbacks from a road, setbacks from property lines. You should also be calling the utility notices to make sure that any underground lines for gas or electric are marked ahead of time.
To be able to do most of the work that we do at Urban Roots in our urban farming program is we work with our youth internship program and volunteers and school groups to really be able to pull up all the projects that we do. We've already had around 100 people come through early this season to help prep the grounds for the high tunnel, lay the cement footings, add compost, and then do some of the construction framing.
A lot of these structures, a non-urban area, would probably just pound the posts in similar to a T-post, just straight into the ground. In an urban area, a lot of folks are finding it's better to put a concrete pier in. The concrete piers are gonna add a lot of weight and stability to that structure, plus they're deeper than what the ground stakes are, so it's gonna provide extra support for that structure. The layout of the structure is the first step. You need to square that structure. They're gonna lay a diagonal line from one corner to the next, and the dimension should be the same between opposite corners. Around the outside of the high tunnel, either plan on farming it, as long as you're controlling erosion, that there isn't gonna be an erosion issue off the structure itself, or putting some type of a landscape fabric or barrier around the outside, because you'll end up getting weeds, especially perennial weeds or rhizome spreading type weeds like quackgrass, spreading underneath from the outside and causing you lots of weeding issues in the future. After the ground stakes are poured, then they're gonna start building those hoops. They're pieced together and screwed together with self-tapping screws. The hoops are usually laid out on the ground. They're slid together. The ends of the pieces are swaged so one fits into the other. And then they're attached with 1 or 2 screws. There's usually a side piece on each side, and then there's 1 or 2 pieces for the hoops. The truss part is attached to the hoops with a cross connector or a strap, and then those hoops are moved onto the ground stakes. You also need to tie each of those hoops together with a purlin, and a lot of them have at least 1, if not 3 or more purlin runs, 1 down the center usually, and then 2 more down the sides. Basically, it makes that structure act as one rather than each individual hoop. The other part of a lot of these structures is they have some type of wind bracing or corner bracing system. The corners are where you can gain some strength with bracing to tie that structure together even more and to provide some wind protection and wind bracing. The baseboards and the hip boards, those also tie that structure together similar as what the purlins would. And that's gonna go along the base of the structure along the length. And that's where you're going to have your roll-up sides anchor into when it's rolled down. And then you're gonna have a hip board, which is the top of that roll-up side. So the bottom of the roof would attach to that hip board for the plastic, and the top of the roll-up sides is attached at that point. The end walls are built differently by just about all producers to make sure that they can get the equipment in and out, and themselves in and out. It's acts as a vent too. They can actually take the end walls off during the summer, or they have large like roll-up doors or other types of doors on there that they can open it up to ventilate it during the summer months. And a lot of them will put end vents at the peak to also allow that hot air and the humidity to escape.
Currently today, we're working with our youth interns to lift the plastic up. And so each group that we work with is really critical to being able to pull off all of these projects for our programming. And so it's gonna be really great for them to be able to, you know, go from this stage of putting it together to be able to planting it and growing it and really see what this high tunnel can produce after all of the work that we've all put into it.
The plastic itself, there's different types of plastic, some that have an IR or infrared treatment on them. There's anti-condensate treatment so that the water droplets don't form on small beads and then drop. The treatment will actually allow water to bead up and then flow off of the plastic but not drop off the plastic onto the plants. And that can help for foliar diseases to keep the leaves dry. For patching that plastic, you're gonna have a what they call a wiggle wire channel that goes over the top, and it's bolted to the frame itself, and the plastic's laid over the top, and there's a wire that literally wiggles in. You're weaving it inside that channel, and it holds that plastic in that channel. You wanna lay that plastic on a calm day. Trying to work with plastic in a windy day can be a nightmare and almost impossible to deal with. You also want to look at a day that has some heat to it, some sun to it, so that plastic's somewhat warm, so that you can stretch that plastic over the frame and attach it to the frame, so when it cools down, it actually kind of shrink wraps or pulls that tight. Otherwise, that plastic, if it's loose and it's flopping around in the wind, will actually degrade faster and wear out quicker over time. It's a 6 mil plastic in general, and it's rated for 4 years, and it's a UV treated plastic. Once the plastic is laid on and attached through the wiggle wire channel, that plastic also holds that structure together more firmly. On average, with an unheated structure like that, you could probably expect about 4 weeks on each end of the growing season additional. Even on a day like today that's mostly cloudy, there's enough sunlight in here that I would guess that that tunnel with the plastic on it would easily gain 20, 30 degrees, and on a sunny day could easily gain 50 to 60 degrees over the ambient air temperature outside.
For the first couple years, we'll probably be doing a lot of trialing to kind of see what does best in this soil and in this growing system and learn the most effective ways for growing here to be able to select crops that are kind of most appropriate for this site and also for what our customers and our community would like to also eat.
The yield in a high tunnel, on average, just as a starting point, you should probably double your production of what you would get outside. Plus, because you have a longer growing season as well, that also improves production and yield as well. The most common types of irrigation would be a drip irrigation or micro irrigation system. A drip tape's gonna have an emitter every anywhere from 6 to 12 inches normally, and you'll have a drip tape per row or a couple of them per bed if you've got a bed system inside the high tunnel. The pest management's interesting because it will reduce some pests and some diseases, but it will also, some diseases and pests that you end up not having outside as much might be more of a problem inside. Plus, if a disease does start in a high tunnel, you have to be on top of it more because it's going to spread faster, because everything happens in a high tunnel faster. Not only the plant growth and the production of vegetables and fruit, but also pests and diseases. Because it's hotter, because it's more humid, things are gonna happen faster. If managed properly, you'll also build soil health faster as well. So less tillage, maybe a cover crop, making sure you're growing crops season long or as long as possible. Adding compost or residues to provide replenishment of their organic matter. Optimum temperatures for soil are anywhere from 45 to 60 degrees for cool season crops to 55 to 75 degrees for warm season crops. If the soil is constantly getting cold from the outside and you have warm loving crops like tomatoes or cucumbers, they're going to get cold shocked. Even the roots will, and they won't perform as well, even if the air temp is warmer.
As it is a season extension, part of our programming now, we'll be able to obviously grow food earlier in the season and kind of later on. So being able to keep management up for production as long as we can. And then throughout the winter, just being able to monitor and maintain the high tunnel with snow loads and wind, and just being able to really understand how it does at this site, since we know that every site is unique for how you kind of have to manage.